thank you very much. I want to start this day's science policy dialogue with a brief summary of the recent scientific findings, which were published last year in the scientific literature. And all of these findings are summarized in the annual science update, which was prepared by the Science Advisory Panel. And you have all the details there. Within my next 10 minutes, I can only pick out some of the most important features. And of course, please refer to the full text. So in summary, I can say that last year there was a huge increase in papers in which are relevant, and scientific studies which are relevant for the work of CCSC, many different directions. I'll summarize some of the key findings. The Science Advisory Panel went through most of these papers, and we basically evaluated the relevance for the purposes of the CCSC, and my talk is somehow structured along these relevances. Let me start with maybe the bad news first. There is very clear evidence from the WMO and from a number of other studies and monitoring data that methane emission, one of the main precursors, or one of the main SLCB emissions, the concentrations of methane in the atmosphere has steadily increased in the last years. There's no sign of a trend reversal. And in 2016, when the last monitoring data are available, the concentrations are now almost between 40% and 50% higher than in pre-industrial times. And this is somehow sign doesn't really show success in tackling the methane emissions, because even the last years the growth has taken up faster, growth rates were faster than in some of the decades before. A number of papers have tried to understand the reasons for this rapid increase, and there are different papers suggesting different possible reasons. A number of papers highlight or provide quite some evidence that emissions have strongly increased in the US and in Russia in the oil and gas sector. Partly some of these emissions have been underestimated before. So new monitoring data suggests that emissions have always been a little bit higher, not a little bit, but significantly higher than what we have thought before. But also the activities have increased significantly. The same is also true for the China coal sector. Chinese papers are suggesting that activities and also the methane emissions have significantly increased. Other papers are suggesting that agricultural sources, like cattle farming and rice paddies, also led to an increase. And at the moment, it's a little bit difficult to come up with a definite answer. But I personally would think that these activities currently suggested by the oil and gas initiatives to get a better understanding about the sources and the emission factors from especially the oil and gas sector and also from the agricultural sector are really well taken. And this is a big concern. Emissions are increasing despite all our efforts, and we do not really understand what the reason is. So I think these activities are well taken. There's also an interesting paper which is looking into a very unconventional direction, and they were showing that the dung from cattle which is treated with antibiotics, and this is widely done in many countries, but they have the dung from this cattle has twice as much methane emissions than cattle without these antibiotics treatments. Very interesting pathway why this is the case. And this goes via the stomachs of some beetles who are eating and digesting the dung. But the very interesting indications which opens up a completely new direction which we were not aware before. On black carbon, there is new work on quantifying the current sources of black carbon, anthropogenic sources of black carbon, now including also some of the sources which are taken up already in the initiatives like the kerosene lamps, diesel generators. Projecting this into the future, basically several papers are suggesting that towards the end of the century, the global black carbon emissions would decline in any case because of the economic development and changes in lifestyle. But there is a large scope for accelerating this decline through policy interactions. And this is exactly what also the CCAC is working on, to reap these near-term benefits, climate benefits, but also health benefits and other benefits from an accelerated decline of black carbon emissions. There's an ongoing debate between the SLCP community and some of the some of the scientists focusing on the climate long-term climate CO2 scenarios, and there's the argument brought that in the long run CO2 mitigation strategies will automatically result as a co-benefit also in lower black carbon emissions. The quantification is also interesting, that in a 50% cut in CO2 emissions, which is not easy to achieve, would indeed result in lower black carbon emissions, but then would only affect 10 to 20%, and only very dramatic decarbonization strategy, which would then end up in negative CO2 emissions eventually. In this case, the black carbon emissions would be reduced by up to 80%. But again, this is a matter of time, and there are many benefits for development, for humans, and also for climate could be achieved by an accelerated implementation of the measures. Another interesting paper, very relevant for our discussion here, refers to the source apportionment of black carbon in the Siberian Arctic. Up to now, indications and models suggested that most of the black carbon found in the Siberian part of the Arctic is originating from flaring activities. But this new paper, based on monitoring and some modeling activities, suggests that 38% of this black carbon deposition concentrations in this area originate from traffic emissions in Europe, in China, and in the densely populated areas in Russia, and also that residential heating contributes another 35%. So a very different perspective from what we thought before. It's not the final verdict. Again, I think we need more work to understand the role of flaring on the Arctic. But there's a very interesting aspect here that some of the activities, if this is right, some of the activities of the coalition would perhaps lead to a faster reduction from focusing on transport and combustion sources. This time we also include new information on the F-gases. There is now more comprehensive F-gas assessments are available. Scenarios which are predicting the business as usual before the Kigali agreement on HFC emissions as a consequence of increased economic activities and changes in lifestyles suggest a really dramatic increase in HFC, a factor of 4 within the next 40 years. It's dramatic. But of course, there is in the meantime, the Kigali amendment has been agreed upon. And if this will be implemented effectively, then much of this increase can be avoided. Now let me switch to the impacts. First, some impacts on climate change. There's new information from studies suggesting that the global warming potential would be higher than what is currently thought. And the main argument, the main reasons for this is that the current calculations and current analysis underestimate the importance of shortwave absorption of methane. So in this case, the GWP, this is a typo here, GWP should be 32 instead of 28, and this is already much higher, 28 as IPCC 5 report, and before it, I think the GWP was 21. So there's much more importance of methane on climate change, on the forcing, and also there is another paper suggesting that the carbon cycle feedbacks are stronger than we thought before, which would again support that methane has a more important role. And if you follow these calculations, then methane would be responsible for about 1/3 of the CO2 forcing, which is more than current numbers would suggest, 1/4 only. For black carbon, there's again, there are many papers in the literature reporting on modeling activities and monitoring and other analysis. One which is not completely conclusive. Not all the elements are understood, all the pathways are understood, but one important new pathway has been highlighted, that non-black carbon particles, which are emitted together with black carbon particles, could enhance the light-absorbing properties of black carbon. And this would mean that biomass burning and particles with sulfates and nitrates could cause more warming than previously thought. And this could be potentially very important. This pathway has not been fully incorporated in many of the other analyses, but it might be, we'll see what this will bring in the future if it's put in context with many other aspects. Impacts on sea level rise. A paper is highlighting that methane and HFCs will let sea levels increase even in a time scale much after this actual the molecules are removed from the atmosphere, because of this the long lag time in the sea level mechanism in the seawater. So therefore the impacts are much longer than the atmospheric lifetime on sea level rise. And for black carbon, there are a number of papers highlighting or exploring the relationships between black carbon concentrations, emissions and concentrations, and precipitation patterns. And there are some interesting and also alarming results found, that currently the estimates are that the aerosols are causing a 40% reduction in the summer precipitation in some parts of China, or a 20-30% decrease in southern Africa, a 25% decrease over North Africa, and also changing of the monsoon pattern. That's work in progress, but it's very important because there's a lot of consequences on the livelihood of people, and understanding is growing. On crops and health impacts, there's an interesting paper suggesting that on a unit basis, climate change, the crop loss from climate change, which is caused by SLCPs, by methane, are much larger than those from if the climate change is caused from CO2. And the main reason for this is that the CO2 has a negative impact on vegetation and climate change, but at the same time has a fertilizing effect. And this fertilizing effect is missing with the SLCPs, so therefore the crop impacts of SLCP, climate change from SLCPs are much, much larger than those from CO2. Caused by CO2. Also very important for the work here. And then there's a lot of papers reporting about health impacts of SLCPs. I think Carlos will talk more about this. Main headlines are that 9 out of 10 people in the world breathe air pollution above the WHO guidelines. And more studies are showing a wide range of new health impacts caused by air pollution, starting from preterm births to Alzheimer and some other interesting diseases. It's, again, work in progress, but there's interesting information coming up. And finally, there are interesting papers, very relevant papers on mitigation and the benefits, and I think these are essentially good news because there are a number of papers show new opportunities for reducing and mitigating methane and black carbon. And one very promising technology has been developed which is converting methane into liquid methanol. And this was, in principle, it was possible before, but it required high temperatures. But now this technology can perform this conversion at about 200 degrees Celsius. And this is would make it possible also at oil wells, instead of the flaring, convert the methane, which is flared otherwise, into liquid methanol. And this would be could be a very interesting option for reducing the emissions from flaring. another very interesting aspect, there are several papers now suggesting that for the fugitive losses in oil and gas production, it is similar, the nature is similar as for transport sources, that a very small share of all the sources causes a very large share of the pollution. And numbers are suggesting, the estimates are suggesting that I think 5% of the oil wells in the US are causing are responsible for 50% of the pollution. And of course this opens also a very important and promising avenue for mitigation, because targeting the super emitters would be very, very effective in bring emissions down with relatively little efforts significantly. For black carbon, it was highlighted, this is not completely new, but this is important to remember, that the new gasoline direct injection engines, many of the new cars, gasoline cars, are now using these engines. They can release high amounts of black carbon and toxic VOCs. And if you run through the full analysis, that these higher emissions could negate the CO2 emissions, the CO2 benefits from lower fuel consumption. So I think it is important in those parts of the world where this is not yet within the focus to keep an eye on this, and also think about emission standards for the GDI engines, because otherwise you get rid of diesel, but then you create an additional source with from the gasoline engines. And then there are a number of quantifications of the temperature benefits from different sources. Now, the main message is now, from a little bit from a distance, what does it mean for the CCAC work? I think our consensus in the science advisory panel is certainly suggesting that the recent studies strengthen the evidence for the negative impacts of SLCP, so we don't see any paper coming out which would say that our earlier estimates and the rationale for the CCAC to take action would have been wrong or mistaken. So I think all the studies are really suggesting that the direction is right, reconfirms the earlier findings, so not questioning some of the findings. In terms of action oriented, I think there are two interesting aspects. The first one is that the emissions from some sectors, and here the oil and gas and agriculture, might be underestimated. There's a number of studies suggesting that currently we underestimate these emissions, and therefore also maybe put too little attention on the mitigation of these sources. And the studies clearly confirm the urgency of effective mitigation in the sectors, and it's very important that they reveal new mitigation options for the emissions in these sectors. This, I think, I want to close here. It's a very quick, fast summary. A lot of details are in the papers. Next level of details you find in the report. If you want more details, talk to us or read the papers. Thank you very much.